I just remembered that when it said socks are optional, the first pastor I served under in North Carolina, Johnny Branch, kudos to him. He was an old beach boy. He just loved being on the beach, had a place on the beach, and any chance he got, he went there. But he never, I mean, never wore socks. And I just thought he was ahead of his time proclaiming that. So socks are optional. I wore my bicycle socks today. So we each have our moment. So what does it mean? What does a reasonable church look like? Is it first church? We've talked about doubters and skeptics and are welcome here because we know we don't have all the answers, but we do know that we want to be in a relationship with one another. And we talked last week about welcoming imperfect people because we are imperfect people who just happen to understand that we've been made perfect through Christ. Not anything we do, but through Christ. So what else does it take to be a reasonable church? Well, today we're going to talk about a place for new beginnings. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you to just be in this space together. And remembering what it meant to come here and to have a new start for each and every one of us, what that was like. And I pray that that would inspire us to hear what you have for us today. That would inspire us to share what we have and find new ways of experiencing that. In Jesus we pray. Amen. So the church has always been home. First Church is a home and all are welcome. We say that all the time. Our greeters have shared that. But like Adam and Eve, at some point we chose to turn away from the church and turn away from God and our home. So even though we did that, it was still always our home. Amen? So God's heart is eternally, eternally open for us. And we are welcome home anytime, at any point. Even if you've never been here before, if this is your first time here, you are welcome home. Like the prodigal son, we have found our way back. You remember he declared to come home, he said in Luke 15, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hands. So he went off to his father. And then my favorite part of this verse, one of my favorite verses in the Bible, but while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. So we too have come home every week, only it's not compassion, it's love. Let's just change that word right now. The Father is representing God to us all, that God, when he sees us headed this way, runs after us and throws God's arms around us and welcomes us home with a kiss. Wow, that's powerful stuff. So we get that every week. But what about people who are still looking for a home? Why haven't they found home? Well, I think one reason is that as holy siblings that we are, we don't always act like holy children of God. Amen? You know what I'm talking about, right? Okay. I didn't hear an amen. Am I the only one here? Hello. I know you said it online. You're welcome. I had the best thing happen in between services. I got to watch a recording of a young girl who I said, go ahead and say amen online. And she recorded and said amen and sent me the video. It was perfect. It was great. So amen. That's a wonderful gift. So we have this thing that we do. We've made this a place, our home, right? We come every week and we're really involved, but we want it a certain way. We've moved the furniture around so it meets our needs, and we like it just the way it is. Church should be like this. We find in our worship services that we have a certain way of doing things. I have a certain way of doing things, and all of it's for the glory of God. But sometimes we forget that not everybody's been a part of this routine. And we go along and all of a sudden the routine becomes the important part of the service. And its purpose is not questioned because it's the routine. But here's the problem. Routine can replace reason for church. Routine can replace reason. For instance, the order of worship is a thing. This is First Church. If you want to be a part of this, you know we are here and this is how we do it. Three songs, then Miguel talks about the offering, then the pastor gets up and yells at us for a while, and that's how we do it. That's the way we did it last week. That's the way we're going to do it this week. This is the right way for us. But is it? I used the example of, it's kind of like we're on a treadmill. I don't know. This may be a perfect way to do church every Sunday, but we're so much on a treadmill, and we have doing the way we did it last week and doing it the way we did last the week before and the week before that we don't take time to stop and look at it. So maybe it's right, but who knows? We're so busy doing what we do, we don't take time to make sure the reason for what we do. God is constantly calling others to join us, to make their place in this place as their home as well. Are we making room? Romans 15:7 says, "Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God." Remember when you came that Christ was here, and you, that first time that you met Christ along the way, and Christ welcomed you. There was a sense that came over you. That's what we need to be about each and every time we worship. How do we make room? Well, we're supposed to celebrate their arrival, which I think our greeters do a great job here at this church. Man, you can't walk in that door without being greeted, and they know, and you can tell that they care about you right from the start. But do we do more than that? Is it just inside the door? Should we make provision for them? If somebody sits in your seat, are you going to be okay with that? That's one of the things we have to think about. We want them to stop being them and become part of us. Amen? That's really what our goal is. But what we often do is judge, whether intentional or not. We judge if they match the decor, so to speak. Worship can be a maze for someone new. Anybody new today? It can. You know what I mean? It's like it can be, now what are we doing? What's it like? Here's an example I want to use. Suppose you had never been to a restaurant in your entire life, and you decide, okay, I'm going to go to a restaurant, and you go to McDonald's. And so you walk in the door, and you go up to McDonald's, and you go up to the counter, and you order your hamburger and fries and your meal package, and you get your food, and you go sit down and eat it, and you think, man, that was great. The food wasn't so good, but it was great. I didn't have to cook it. I didn't have to do anything. And it was really good. So you keep coming back, and you come back next week, and you come back next week. But eventually you think, gosh, I'd like to try a new restaurant. So I'm going to go up the street a ways. And the very next restaurant up the street is Coastal. Now, can you imagine what would happen when you walk into Coastal if you tried to go up to the counter and order your hamburger and say, I'll take the meal deal? How are they going to react? How's everybody in the restaurant going to react? That, my friends, is what church can be like for new visitors. We look and say, well, they didn't stand up at the right time. What's up with that? They didn't do this. They didn't do that. One thing I can talk about to couples when they're getting married is talking about empathy in a relationship. Mason, you'll hear about this soon. I talk about stepping into each person's shoes. You see, the relationship or the issue or the moment we step into their shoes, those issues or moments become a different point of view. I tell them if they want to win an argument, and this is the truth, and all families can try this and all couples can try that. So if you want to win an argument, the best way is to step into the other person's shoes and then talk about the argument or the disagreement from that point of view. It works. I don't think we do that enough in First Church. I don't think we step into other people's shoes much. We come and we enjoy the music and enjoy the spirit. I love you all and we love each other and we're comfortable with each other because we are all here together. But are we aware of what it's like to walk through these doors for the first time? For us, it was just last week and the week before and the week before and the week before. So we know exactly how it works. Amen? But for somebody new, it's something different. As somebody that's looking for a relationship in Christ, and they come in the door and they're kind of frozen because they don't really know. Christ stepped into our shoes. So let's carry it forward and step into their shoes. Amen? That's what God's calling us to do. You know, one of the hardest things for me the first day I came here was figuring out where the front of the church was. Anybody else have that problem? Man, it's like you think it's over there on Dunlop, and then you keep looking for doors, but all you see is cement. And finally, you drive up this nondescript alley, and there's the front door. That's what I did when I came to meet everybody at this church. It'd be almost 14 years ago now that's the way it was. Another one is the bathrooms. When you come in the front door, if you don't know where the bathrooms are, you have to look for a while, right? These are all things that happen, but we just take them for granted. You know what? The next person that comes through the door is going to have the same problem. We need the sign lady out saying, front door's this way, every week. And we need somebody saying, hi, welcome. If you happen to need to use the restrooms, they're right over here to our right. Welcome. Welcome. I mean, simple little things are things that we need to consider doing. And that's what we're called to do. Carry it forward. Step into their shoes. They're the ones we want to welcome and love as God has called us to do so. And we want to know what it's like for them. What do we need to explain? What do we need to enhance? What do we need to explore? What do we need to extinguish to make room for others? A few years ago, our worship leader at the time asked me what that thing was after we hear the scripture passage for the day. The word of God for the people of God. And everyone says back, thanks be to God. Most of you know it. Some of you don't. He thought that was spooky. He'd never heard that before. He came here and he's like, what was that? And I tried to explain to him that's what we do after we read the scripture. But it was spooky to him because he'd never heard that. So we changed it right away and offered a prayer. And there was some complaining. 1 Peter 4:9 says, be hospitable to one another without complaining, by the way. But it is part of the furniture. We say it by habit. Not really by purpose. Are we really saying the word of God? I'm thinking about every word I'm saying. The word of God for the people of God. If we don't really say it on purpose, from his shoes, from the worship leader's shoes, I could see how it seemed mysterious and off-putting. And you had to be in the club to be able to say those words. So what else is mysterious? What makes people feel like outsiders? We can move the furniture around. Can we do that? We can take some of the furniture out or maybe bring in some of their furniture so they feel comfortable, this becomes part of their home as well. But when we set aside our preconceived notions for the Spirit of God, then we let the Spirit of God design our future. Our very worship that day gets designed by God. That's powerful. Now, let me warn you, if you literally move the furniture, it can be dangerous. One Sunday several years ago, I got this big idea, and we decided we were going to change it up for everybody. And when you walk through the door, you were invited to sit in the circle that represented your month of birth. It was really cool. We had these circles here. People hated it. In fact, two people never came back to this church from that day on to this day, have never returned to this church because we made circles and we did something different. We had a wonderful time and people talked to each other in church. They shared their faith in church and it was powerful and it was an amazing moment, but it was dangerous because people are going to get mad. Listen to Isaiah 43, beginning at verse 18. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. God has more in store for us than what we do on the treadmill day after day. The early Christians dealt with the same kind of problems and the same obstacles, and often paid for it with their life. We hear in Acts 4 about when two of the disciples healed someone by the power of risen Christ and were arrested for doing such a thing. When they had made the prisoners, when they made them stand in front of them, they inquired, by what power or by what name do you do this? And it says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of the good deeds done to someone who is sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead." That's powerful. Amen? And then it goes on to say this. "This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given by among mortals by which he must be saved." Is the church held together today by that same cornerstone? Is it held together by the right cornerstone, is the question. Like God always does, it is the reject that became the cornerstone, the essential. Tell me that doesn't speak to you. It speaks to me because I'm a reject. I'm really good at that. I told you last week, I screw up regularly. That's who I am. And yet that's who God incorporates into the building of the body of Christ. The people that, that have been rejected by others. But the problem is we've now become the builders. We're starting to look them around and say, well, that corner, what's going on? The cornerstone's missing. Are we rejecting the essential piece of the kingdom of God by the way we built worship, our lives together? I think we need to go back to God's drawing board. I can tell you that that's where I need to go. If we could look through the eyes of God or the shoes of Jesus, if you will, what would we think about the way we do church and the way we are church? Remember, the cornerstone is the reject. And I got to tell you, I hear that and I'm cut to the quick because I'm not sure that I always welcome the reject. I'm not sure I haven't forgotten that I once was the reject and was welcomed by Christ. The cornerstone is the one that doesn't feel comfortable here. So how do we start with this new idea in our mind, with this new understanding in our mind, that the reject is the cornerstone? The person that walks through the door that feels the least comfortable is who Christ was coming into this world. Amen? Amen? We need the Spirit in this place. If you're at home, you can text me or record it and send it to me. That'd be great. Either one is fine. But amen, that's what we need. The title of this sermon is A Place for New Beginnings. And to us that have been here week after week, that sounds very inviting to those people, doesn't it? That sounds like, oh, listen, this is a new place for welcome. But what if the message from God today is about us looking for new beginnings? What if we are looking for a new beginning by the power of the Spirit of God? Amen? Amen. Ephesians 4:20, beginning in verse 22. "You were taught to put away your former life, your old self, corrupt and deluded by its lusts, and to be renewed by the Spirit of your minds, and to clothe yourselves with the new self, created according to the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." That's who God wants us to be. That's who God is after. What has brought about the kingdom lately? Has it been the sermons? Has it been the music we sing? Or has it been the lives we lead or try to lead, at least on Sunday for an hour, whatever it is? No. 1 John 3:18 says, "Little children, let us love not in word and speech, but in truth and action." God's love is in our actions. Our action now must be for others to make this home as well. So we got to put away all our comfortable thoughts and all the things and recognize that the Spirit, we may be doing it right, but does anybody know if we don't let the Spirit into the moment, we're missing it. And that's where we're called to be. That was Jesus' mission. And that's our mission, to bring people to Christ. Isn't this what Christ is calling us to? You recognize these first couple of verses from John 10, beginning in verse 14. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. But then there's verse 16. It goes on and says, I have other sheep. We don't hear this very often. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. You see, God is calling us to the reject in our, what we would call reject. I see the possibility of our future completely different than what we expect. Heck, next week we might come in here and I might do triangles, okay? We're going to come in here and everybody sit in a triangle. It's Trinitarian. It would make sense, right? I had somebody say in the first service, they're going to sneak in here next week and turn all the seats around the other direction. Not a bad idea. I like it. It'll work. All need new beginnings in the life of Christ. Amen? We all need that. Richard Rohr talked to me again this morning in my devotion, so of course you get a part of that. Here it is. Yearning for a new day will not produce it. Only ending the old way can do that. Get off the treadmill, in other words. You cannot hold on to the old all the while declaring that you want something new. The old will defy the new. The old will deny the new. The old will decry the new. There is only one way to bring in the new. You must make room for it. Did God not send Richard Rohr this morning? I think we're prepared to do that. A tornado called COVID-19 hit our home, and we adapted and survived by the grace of God. And maybe, just maybe, it opened the door to possibilities, new beginnings. If somebody was here for the first time, this would be a great day for them. If you're fairly new, this is a great day for you because we want to hear from you. We need you to open our eyes to the possibilities. 2 Corinthians 5:13 from our passage today. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on because we are convinced that one has died for all. Just like we were welcomed, just like the prodigal son was hugged and kissed, so we too must do with the community that comes. What if we looked at each week as a possibility to be a new creation in the Spirit? What if we threw our text sheets away and, oh, sorry, Miguel, we can't. What, can you imagine if we did that, threw our text sheets away and just said, God, what do you want us to do? I don't have a clue what it looks like because we haven't done that for a while. But let's put on somebody else's shoes. Here's an interesting thought. What if we put on Jesus' sandals? Because the scripture says that what we will be doing when we do put on someone else's shoes, in Matthew 25:40, it says, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it for me. What if we found some new shoes to step into? Let's join the adventure of new beginnings that Christ gave us with his life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I just want to invite